Hello everyone, I am Dr. Trupti Ramteke. Welcome to my YouTube channel Enjoy Biochemistry. In protein metabolism video lecture series, today we are going to learn about glycine metabolism, and the specific learning objective is at the end of this session, students shall be able to describe synthesis, degradation, that is metabolism of glycine, its metabolic role in the synthesis of variety of specialized product and associated disorders. Let's begin with the introduction of glycine. Glycine is the simplest amino acid and it is the only amino acid which does not exhibit optical isomerism. It is the non-essential amino acid. And this glycine is synthesized from serine, means this is the reversible reaction. The serine can be converted into glycine, as well as glycine can be degraded to serine, and it depends upon the availability of tetrahydrofolate. So this is also involved in one carbon metabolism. It is the glucogenic amino acid because glucose can be synthesized from the glycine. Glyoxylate can be formed from glycine, as well as glycine can be synthesized from glyoxylate. So that reaction is also reversible. Glycine is incorporated in the structure of collagen. It is involved in the synthesis of heme, glutathione, creatine, purines, and ultimately nucleic acids. It has important role in the conjugation of bile acids, and it is involved in the detoxification reactions. Synthesis and catabolism of glycine involves three important reactions. The first is interconversion into serine, means glycine can be converted to serine and glycine can be synthesized from serine. So this is the reversible reaction. Second reaction is oxidative cleavage of glycine into carbon dioxide and ammonia. So there can be formation of carbon dioxide and ammonia from glycine, as well as glycine can be synthesized from carbon dioxide and ammonia. So this is also a reversible reaction. Third is oxidative deamination of glycine to glyoxylic acid. So glycine is degraded to glyoxylate and it can also be synthesized from glyoxylate. So these are the three major and important metabolic reactions which are involved in the synthesis as well as catabolism of glycine. How the synthesis of glycine occurs? Glycine is synthesized from serine by the action of enzyme serine hydroxymethyl transferase. This reaction requires tetrahydrofolate and pyridoxal phosphate. So glycine is synthesized from serine, as well as glycine can be degraded to serine by the same reaction. So this is the reversible reaction. Glycine can also be synthesized from threonine by the action of enzyme threonine aldolase. It can also be synthesized from carbon dioxide and ammonia by the action of enzyme glycine synthase, and this enzyme is a multi-enzyme complex. It requires NAD, tetrahydrofolate, carbon dioxide, ammonia and lipoamide, and that's why it is called as multi-enzyme complex. So glycine is synthesized from serine, threonine, carbon dioxide and ammonia, and it can be degraded to serine and carbon dioxide and ammonia, because this conversion, interconversion of serine and glycine and interconversion of glycine to carbon dioxide and ammonia, these are the reversible reactions. Then this serine can be converted to pyruvate by serine dehydratase, and pyruvate is further involved in the synthesis of glucose, and that's why this glycine is glucogenic amino acid, because through the serine there is formation of pyruvate and later on glucose, and that's why this glycine is termed as glucogenic amino acid. Now what happens to the serine? Serine can be decarboxylated to form ethanolamine and later deaminated to form glycocholate. What happens to this glycocholate? It is converted into glyoxylate, and this glyoxylate can be transaminated by enzyme glycine transaminase to glycine. which means that glycine can be formed by glyoxylate as well. Glycine can also be degraded to glyoxylate by the other enzyme, that is glycine oxidase. And the fate of glyoxylate is formation of formate, and this is involved in the one carbon pool. The other fate is formation of oxalate, which is excreted in urine, and excess amount can result in the precipitation of calcium oxalate stone. So this is the glycine metabolism. Glycine is synthesized from serine, threonine, carbon dioxide and ammonia, and glyoxylate as well. It can be degraded to serine and carbon dioxide and ammonia and glyoxylate, and glyoxylate is further converted to oxalate and formate. Formate is involved in the one carbon pool, and oxalate is excreted in the urine. Coming to the metabolic role of glycine, which specialized products are synthesized from this glycine? First is the synthesis of purine ring. The carbon number 4, carbon number 5 and nitrogen 7, these are derived from glycine. So glycine is involved in the synthesis of purine ring, particularly carbon 4, carbon 5 and N7. Second, it is involved in the synthesis of heme. For synthesis of heme, glycine is required in the first reaction, that is glycine combines with succinyl-CoA, and by the action of enzyme ALA synthase, there is formation of delta aminoleolunic acid, that is ALA. So for synthesis of heme, glycine is required. So it has important role in the synthesis of heme. Third, the action of glycine as neurotransmitter. Glycine, along with the taurine, it acts as an inhibitory neurotransmitter in the spinal cord and brainstem. How does it act? It acts by increasing the permeability of chloride ions. So glycine is important as neurotransmitter also. The next metabolic role of glycine is formation of glutathione. Glutathione is biologically important tripeptide because it is synthesized from three amino acids, glycine, cysteine and glutamic acid. So glycine has important role in the formation of glutathione. This glutathione is a component of important antioxidant enzyme, that is glutathione peroxidase. And this has a vital role in scavenging free radicals from the biological system. It maintains the integrity of RBC membrane. So we will discuss this glutathione, its function, in separate video. So the important metabolic role of glycine is formation of glutathione along with cysteine and glutamic acid. The next role is in the conjugation. It is conjugating agent. It conjugates bile acids. So cholic acid combines with glycine to form glycocholic acid, and quinodeoxycholic acid is combines with glycine to form glycoquinodeoxycholic acid. So it plays a major role in conjugation reaction. The next metabolic role of glycine is formation of collagen. This collagen has three important amino acids, glycine, proline and hydroxyproline, and this collagen has rich content of glycine, about 30%. In fact, every third amino acid in the structure of collagen is glycine, because glycine is very small and it is easily accommodated in the limited space which is available along the central axis of triple helix structure of collagen. So it plays a very important role in the collagen formation along with proline and hydroxyproline. Then it has important role in detoxification reactions. Glycine combines with benzoic acid to form hippuric acid, and it is then excreted. Glycine is glucogenic amino acid because it is involved in the synthesis of glucose through serine. Serine is converted to pyruvate, and pyruvate is then involved in the synthesis of glucose. It is also a constituent of various tissue proteins, hormones and enzymes. Glycine is also involved in the formation of creatine, and this creatine synthesis requires other two amino acids apart from glycine. Glycine, arginine and methionine, GAM. So creatine is synthesized from glycine, arginine and methionine. And the formation of creatine involves three major organs. The first is kidney, liver and muscle. Please note that creatine is not synthesized in muscle. It is just stored in the muscle in the form of creatine phosphate. It is synthesized mainly in the kidney and liver. So the first step of formation of creatine is the guanidino group from arginine is transferred to glycine. So glycine and arginine combines, means there is transfer of guanidino group from arginine to glycine to form guanidoacetate by the action of enzyme amidino transferase. And in this reaction, ornithine is released. Ornithine and arginine, these are the intermediates of urea cycle. This is the first reaction. This is the first step, and it is seen in the mitochondria of kidney. It is not seen in the liver. The first step occurs in kidney. Then the second step. Second step occurs in liver. So this guanidino acetate, it accepts methyl group from S-adenosyl methionine, that is SAM. SAM is an active methyl donor. It is an active form of methionine. So that methyl group is accepted by guanidoacetate to form creatine, and S-adenosyl homocysteine is released. This reaction is catalyzed by enzyme methyl transferase, and this reaction takes place in the liver. So the first reaction occurs in kidney, second reaction occurs in liver, and in the liver there is formation of creatine. So three amino acids are involved: glycine, arginine and methionine, the active form of methionine, that is S-adenosyl methionine. Now what happens to this creatine, the third step? This creatine is phosphorylated to form creatine phosphate, and the enzyme which catalyzes this reaction is creatine kinase. This enzyme is present in muscle, brain and liver, and this reaction requires hydrolysis of ATP. And in the muscle, the creatine is stored in the form of creatine phosphate. And during muscle contraction, the energy is first derived from ATP hydrolysis, and thereafter the ATP is regenerated by the hydrolysis of creatine phosphate, and this is called Lohmann's reaction. And this enzyme creatine kinase, it has a clinical significance because it has three isoenzymes, CKBB, CKMB and CKMM. So this CKMB is important in myocardial infarction. It is increased in myocardial infarction, and CKMM, it is mainly increased in the muscle disorders, for example muscular dystrophy. This is the third reaction, that is phosphorylation of creatine to creatine phosphate, and in the form of creatine phosphate it is stored in the muscle. Now the fourth step is formation of creatine. So when creatine, one water molecule from creatine is lost, there is formation of creatinine. So creatinine is the anhydride of creatine, and this is the spontaneous reaction. This creatinine can also be formed from creatine phosphate, and ultimately this creatine is excreted in the urine, and in the serum this creatinine is the kidney function test, means it is used to assess the levels of serum creatinine, are used to assess the renal dysfunction. So this is the clinical significance of creatinine. So glycine is involved in the formation of creatine along with the other two amino acids, arginine and methionine. First step occurs in the kidney, and there is formation of guanidoacetate. Second step occurs in the liver. It leads to formation of creatine. Then creatine is phosphorylated to form creatine phosphate in the muscle. It is stored in the muscle, and creatinine is anhydride of creatine, which is excreted in the urine. Coming to the metabolic disorders of glycine, the first one is primary hyperoxaluria. This is the autosomal recessive condition due to defect in the enzyme glycine transaminase, and it is characterized by high urinary excretion of oxalate. So what happens? Glyoxylate cannot be converted into glycine because the enzyme glycine transaminase which catalyzes this reaction is defective. And due to this, there is increased concentration of glyoxylate. There are two fates of glyoxylate. The first one is formation of formate and oxalate. So formation of formate from glyoxylate also cannot occur, and That's why there is more formation of oxalate from this glyoxylate, and that's why there is high urinary excretion of oxalate, and this increased level of oxalate results in urolithiasis, that is the stone in urinary tract. And this is the nephrocalcinosis, because the calcium oxalate deposits, they occur in the kidneys, and because of this nephrocalcinosis there is recurrent infections of urinary tract. And death can also occur in childhood or early adult life from renal failure. Next metabolic disorder is glycinuria, that is excretion of glycine. It is an inborn error where there is increased excretion of glycine through urine, though the plasma concentration of glycine is normal. Glycine concentration in the blood is normal, but still there is excretion of glycine through urine, and this is because of defect in the renal tubular reabsorption of glycine. And that's why there is increased tendency for the formation of oxalate renal stones. Non-ketotic hyperglycinemia is also metabolic disorders of glycine. It is due to defect in the glycine cleavage enzyme, that is glycine synthase, of catabolic pathway of glycine. Because glycine is catabolized to carbon dioxide and ammonia with the help of this enzyme glycine synthase, and if this enzyme is defective, then there is increased concentration of glycine. So elevated serum levels of glycine is seen in these patients. So it leads to severe mental deficiencies, and it can occur in the very early childhood. And high levels of glycine can lead to neurological defects, because glycine is inhibitory neurotransmitter. Let's summarize today's topic. Glycine is the simplest amino acid, and it is non-essential and glucogenic. It is synthesized from serine, glyoxylate, threonine, carbon dioxide and ammonia. It is degraded to serine, glyoxylate, oxalate and carbon dioxide and ammonia and formate. The metabolic role of glycine is that it is involved in the synthesis of heme along with the succinyl-CoA. Creatine can be formed from glycine along with the arginine and methionine. Important tripeptide, that is glutathione, it is formed from glycine, cysteine and glutamic acid. C4, C5 and N7 of purine ring are derived from glycine. It is involved in the detoxification reaction. It is involved in the conjugation of bile acids. It adds to the 1-carbon metabolism by forming formate. It is essential amino acid of collagen structure along with the proline and hydroxyproline. It is the inhibitory neurotransmitter. So these are the various important metabolic roles of glycine. And the disorders which are associated with glycine metabolism are primary hyperoxaluria, glycinuria, non-ketotic hyperglycinemia. So I hope this video is helpful to you. Thank you for watching.